Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind. Graphic Audio presents Galactic Football League 1, The Rookie, Part 2, by Scott Sigler. Narrated by Michael John Casey. With performances by Michael John Casey, Thomas Keegan, Jonathon Church, Terence Aselford, Michael Glenn, Eric Messner, Jonathon Feuer, Andy Brownstein, Nick DePinto, Tony Nam, Kenyatta Rogers, Richard Rowan, Jonathon Watkins, James Konicek, Bradley Smith, Matthew Bassett, Jefferson A. Russell, Eric Singdahlsen, Ken Jackson, Chris Davenport, Nora Achrati, Scott McCormick, Tia Shearer, Colleen Delany, Patrick Stratton, Kimberly Gilbert, Maggie Donnelly, and Duane Beeman.
From space, Wittok's upper atmosphere looked a pale lime green. As the shuttle sliced into the soupy air, Quinton saw the all-encompassing cloud cover was actually a sulfurous yellow. The blazing light of the blue star at the center of the Wittok system reflected off the yellow outer atmosphere, the two colors combining for a peaceful green. That peaceful sensation faded away as the shuttle drove towards the planet. The closer they came to the surface, the darker it became. Miles-long bursts of lightning rippled through the dark sky, illuminating the ubiquitous clouds in milky yellow explosions of light. Within minutes of the descent, all sunlight faded away, the shuttle coursing through Wittok's perpetual twilight.
Is it always this dark?
Shizzle fluttered about the small cabin.
Is, and has been for the last 145 years.
The creature fluttered to a stop on Quentin's shoulder.
Find your own seat, pal.
Quentin gently brushed Shizzle away. The Kretorakian translator landed on the seat's armrest.
The Sklorno Navy used relativity bombs on Wittok in 2524. They fired dense projectiles at near light speeds. At that speed, the projectiles literally punched right through the core and out the other side. The planet did not break apart, but the entry and exit points alone were the sources of devastation like nothing the galaxy had ever seen. The shock waves destroyed surface life for thousands of miles in all directions. The projectiles also mixed up Wittok's inner molten nickel core and the outer layer of molten iron. This caused huge shifts in the tectonic plates, and Wittok suffered decades of massive quakes and volcanoes. Gases from the core filled the atmosphere, killing any life that survived the initial impacts, and Wittok's climate was forever changed. It was 75 years before the tectonic plates settled into relative stability. The key word is relative, mind you, because the surface is still plagued with volcanoes that reach as high as 5 miles into the air. Some estimate it will be another 500 to 1,000 years before the crust settles completely and the volcanoes become dormant.
How come Ioneth isn't like that? The Sklorno set bombed Ioneth too, right?
They did, but they didn't use relativity bombs, which caused so much damage to Wittok that they've never been used again. The results even scared the Sklorno, who wondered if such destructive weapons might someday be utilized against their homeworld. For future wars, they instead developed the massive nuclear bombs that were used on Ioneth and Grichlik.
Wow, that was awfully nice of them.
They are a one-minded species. They're part of the reason we Kretorakians took over. We feared that if left to yourselves, the warlike races of Human, Ki, Hara, and especially Sklorno might completely exterminate one another.
Quentin looked out the window at the blank darkness.
Save me the lecture, Shizzle. I've heard it all before.
The amazing thing is that despite the almost complete destruction of Wittok, and the fact that the planet is among the most hostile places in the galaxy, the Quith managed to successfully develop permanent cities. Ah, we're coming out of the clouds now. Behold, the port of Wittok.
Quentin pressed against the viewport, eager to see his second alien city. The lightless clouds thinned to nothing.
It just looks like a smaller version of Ioneth City. The domed downtown, the roads.
The port of Wittok was built well after the success of Ioneth and Grichlik. The Quith's first pioneers landed 51 years after the relativity bombing, but the planet's surface was still so violent they could barely survive. It was another 50 years before they built an actual port that allowed large craft landings. The city itself is really only about 60 years old. The perpetual blanket of night is thanks to volcanoes that spill fumes into the upper atmosphere. Earthquakes, too, are a daily occurrence. But here, every structure, the streets, all utilities like pipes, power transmitters, and atmosphere processors rest on a mag-grav suspension system. Quakes hit 4 or 5 times a day, but seldom pose a problem.
The shuttle swooped down towards the huge dome. Just like Ioneth City, the dome's surface seemed to open just for the speeding shuttle. Many of the buildings looked very similar to Ioneth City's, and right at the city center sat a perfectly round stadium.
It looks bigger than ours.
EA and M Stadium seats 181,500. Every game is a sellout. No sunlight on the planet's surface hinders outdoor activities. There's not much to do, so beings on Witok take football very seriously.
More seriously than Ioneth?
Last week, there were 5 murders involving tickets for the game against the Big Diggers.
The shuttle banked a landing pad atop a building attached to the stadium. Shizzle's history lesson faded away as the vehicle lowered for the landing. Quentin stared out the window at the field, his mind switched into full-out strategy mode. Here, the surface wasn't blue, but a pale yellow, with black lines and numbers. He had read up on the stadium in his effort to prepare as completely as possible. The plant that made up the field was reportedly a bit oily, making for poor traction and quickly stained uniforms.
How am I going to run the offense on such poor footing? It's going to affect the receiver's routes for sure.
Quentin walked out the Holy Light bar and onto the streets of Port Witok. The Holy Light, similar to the Blessed Lamb on Ioneth, was a purist-only place where you could get good food, religion, and reasons to hate everything except those that hailed from the purest nation space. Warburg had brought him there. He ate politely, made friends, but Quentin excused himself shortly after dinner. He grew tired of Warburg's constant verbal attacks on anyone and anything that was not Nationalite. Before leaving, he asked around if anyone could help him track down his parents. The people he spoke to offered to help him unconditionally. Quentin still had trouble believing that Nationalites liked him and wanted to help him, even though he was an orphan. Being an orphan seemed to have little meaning to people who had fled their home planets in fear for their lives, leaving behind family, belongings, and culture. Quentin walked alone down the street, weaving through the crowds of Quith, Key, Human, and Sklorno. He had a lot on his mind. Practice was going well, although he still had problems. He now got rid of the ball twice as fast as he had when with the Raiders, but it didn't solve the main problem, which was adjusting his eyes to take in the whole field. What was worse, the Kraken seemed to simply tolerate him as opposed to accepting him as their leader. They were still Pine's players.
Why do they follow that has-been? I'm a better quarterback and everyone knows it. Pine has full command in the huddle. When I'm in, I get glares or bored looks. And the Key don't block as well for me as they do for Pine. The human players are no better. Aside from Warburg, the human starters show little respect, well, except for Faid, who runs every play as if his life depended on it. Obviously, they want to keep the little status quo with their buddy Don Pine. Well, it's my team now, and they're all going to learn that come game time.
He was so lost in his thoughts, he didn't hear the flutter of Kredorakian wings right beside him. He didn't even know the little creature was there until it spoke.
Quentin Barnes?
Quentin turned to look toward the voice. The Kredorakian had light yellow skin with mottled brown spots and wore a plain brown outfit. It hovered near his head, reminding Quentin of a big, noisy hummingbird with 6 eyes.
Yes, that's me.
My name is Magon, and I'd like a word with you. Or more precisely, my employer would like a word with you.
Yeah? And who is your employer?
Magon handed him a business disc. Quentin thumbed the button at the center. A small hologram appeared above it. Magon, Talent Scout, Toe Pirates.
You're really from the Pirates?
Yes, but it's better if we don't talk here. Your teammates might see. Follow me.
Magon flew down a side street. Quentin followed him down the street, then into a small door he had to duck to get through. Once inside, he was able to stand, but just barely, his hair touching the ceiling. The place was full of Quith workers in various states of intoxication. Some danced to strange music, some leaned against numerous 3-foot-high poles that filled the room, and some laid on the floor. The smell of juniper filled the air.
What is this place?
A gin joint.
Magon fluttered down atop one of the poles. He was the only Kredorakian in the room. For that matter, Quentin was the only human.
I forgot that you don't know much about the galaxy. Gin, the same thing you humans distill and consume, has a powerful narcotic effect on the Quith. Most alcohol doesn't affect them, but there's something in gin that really knocks them out.
Quentin thought back to the time he'd seen an opium den back on Mycovi. Human or Quith worker, stoners all look the same.
Pathetic.
If you think these workers are bad now, you should see the ones that are hooked on raw juniper berries. At least the gin is distilled to take out some of the poisons.
Quentin took another look around, then turned to Magon.
Okay, so what's this about? What do the pirates want?
They want you.
What? They want me now?
Not now, idiot. At the end of the season, Kirani Akolok will give you a 3-year contract.
3-year contract? Sounds great. Tell Mr. Kolok I'm very interested.
Of course you're interested, Backwater. It's the Toe Pirates. Everybody's interested. But there's one catch.
Which is?
You have to make sure the Krakens don't make the playoffs.
Quentin's face furrowed.
But why not? What difference does that make?
Magon fluttered his wings, a clear sign of irritation.
Because, Backwater, if the Krakens make the playoffs and make it into Tier 1, all players are protected for 2 years. That means that the Pirates, or any other team for that matter, can't touch you unless the Krakens cut or trade you.
Oh, yeah. Forgot about that.
But it doesn't look like it's going to be a problem. You guys are already 1-1, and there's no way you're going to beat the Pioneers. So you'll be 2 games out of first place. Just make sure the Krakens lose any games you start, and you'll be wearing the blood red before you know it. Mr. Kolok thinks there are big things in your future. If I need to talk to you again, I'll contact you, but we can't be seen together. If the League finds out we're talking, the Pirates will be fined and you'll be suspended.
Suspended?
Quentin quickly looked around the bar, but still only saw drunken Quith workers.
Why didn't you say that before we started talking?
Not my fault you don't know GFL regulations. Now, if you'll excuse me, I must go. I can't stand the stink of humans.
Bagon fluttered up and flew out the door. Quentin stared after him.
The Toe Pirates, winners of 5 Galaxy Bowls, and they want me.
But Magon's words pushed to the forefront of his brain, dissipating his excitement.
Lose any games I start. We're struggling, but with a win against the Pioneers, the Krakens are right back in the race.
Quentin shook his head and crossed to the exit. He'd never thrown a game in his life, but odds were he wouldn't have to.
Pioneers are the best team in the Quith Irradiated Conference. It won't come down to me tanking a game. At least I hope not.
Quentin stood at the front of the pack, the Kraken's players crammed into the tunnel. It seemed wider and newer than the one at Ionith Stadium. In fact, everything about the stadium reeked of newness. From the full wall of multi-race vending machines in the team lobby to the small paint lockers that changed color to suit each player's preference. The communications equipment was state-of-the-art, but what else would you expect from a stadium sponsored by a telecom company like Earth Ansible and Messenger? Stadium's quality, however, faded to insignificance as the game fever started to overtake Quentin. The Kraken's players bounced and twitched with anticipation of battle. Pheromones filled the air, the thick scent of key aggression combining with the tang of human sweat. An electrical charge ripped through the unified mass of players, cycling from one end to the other and back again.
Time to draw the battle line!
Isud was somewhere in the back, his voice muffled by the tight press of bodies packed into the tunnel.
We will accept Condor's gifts!
Milford referred to Condor Adrienne, the Pioneer star quarterback. The other Sklornos began bouncing up and down, unable to contain their energy. The sensation built up quickly, thickly, so intense that Quentin couldn't even think, he could only feel, like an animal waiting to pounce. It was like the last 2 games, but it was different. This time, they were his to command, his to lead. The moment he'd waited for all his life.
Welcome to Wittok, the Ionith Krakens!
Drink all the moon!
The team surged out of the tunnel to the sound of booze. Small, hard items clinked off their armor. Bits of wet matter, both cold and hot, spilled down on them as they ran onto the field. Quentin covered his head as he looked up to the stands and saw an endless sea of midnight blue and neon green, the colors of the Wittok Pioneers. Reaching the sidelines, the team surged around him like a python, everywhere at once, pressing in, their eyes on him, their breath in his face and on his neck. They bounced and surged and punched and clawed, like a tiger in a cage.
All right.
This is it! This is it! Pine is out, so we gotta pull together. This is war. We gotta take the battle to them. We need this win. We want it more than they do. We must win!
Teams surged even tighter one last time, bouncing Quentin like a cork in a typhoon.
Win on three! One, two, three!
Win!
Then the scrum broke and the players hustled away, preparing for the game. Quentin fumed on the sidelines. The Pioneers won the toss, received the kick, and started with the ball on their own 28. Condor Adrienne wasted no time, dropping back on the first play. His offensive line, a huge wall of key averaging 360 pounds, gave him all the time in the world. Adrienne launched a deep pass to a streaking receiver who sprang high in the air. Davenport, the Kraken's right cornerback, went up high as well, but she was just a step behind. The ball floated down just an inch away from her outstretched tentacles, who dropped perfectly into the hands of Banger, the Pioneers' receiver. The two players came down as one, but Davenport stumbled on impact. Banger sprinted the remaining 15 yards into the end zone.
That ain't a good sign.
Giant pom-poms and flags, all midnight blue lined with neon green, waved in the air, making the 181,500-plus crowd seem like a single massive anemone. The kick was good. The first play of the game found the Wichita Pioneers up 7-0. The Kraken's offense gathered to take the field.
We've got our work cut out for us. Let's get that one back.
Richfield returned the kick to the Kraken's 30. The offense ran onto the field. The pom-poms and banners vanished like that same anemone, pulling in its flowery tentacles at the first hint of danger. As the players huddled up, Quentin took one look around the stadium.
Boy, they love us here, don't they?
Utaro Kobayashi, the tight end, stood beside Quentin in the huddle.
We won here two seasons ago. The crowd rioted. 27 beings died before they got it under control.
Tom Perilous, the fullback, was on Quentin's right.
They don't mess, man. You gotta love it.
Okay, let's take care of business.
Quentin tapped his right ear hole to activate the heads-up display inside its visor. Hokor had already specified the first 20 offensive plays. Quentin knew them by heart, having reread the list 100 times, but he checked again just to be sure. He tapped a button and the list of players disappeared from the visor.
Why set belly right, on one, ready?
Break!
Pure hate distilled from the 181,500-plus crowd. Quentin surveyed the defense. Middle linebacker Kagan the Crazy, a thickly built Quith warrior, was the most dangerous player on the team. He loved to blitz, especially delayed blitzes, and already had 3 sacks in his first 2 games. The defensive line was nothing special, allowing an average of 168 yards on the ground. Hokor wanted to control the ball and keep Adrienne off the field as much as possible. Quentin scanned the defensive backfield and recognized his opponents for the afternoon. Houston, the right corner, lacks the height and jumping ability to match premier receivers. Tumwater, the safety, was playing with a hurt right tentacle. Westland, the free safety, known for her devastating hits, and Phoenix, the left corner, who had poor speed giving up long passes over the top.
Green, 19! Green, 19! Hut!
Quentin turned to the right and handed off to Faid. The Pioneers linebackers came quickly on a run blitz, knocking Faid backwards and stuffing the play to the line of scrimmage. Quentin looked at the sidelines, but Hokor said nothing over the ear speaker. Quentin tapped his heads-up display to double-check the next play. Another run.
Huddle up!
As the first quarter wore on, it became obvious that the Pioneers weren't going to let Mitchell the Machine Faid run wild. They run blitzed, stacked linebackers in the gaps, and didn't use pass coverage formations like the nickel package, even on third downs. The Kraken's first 2 possessions were 3 and outs. Quentin didn't even throw his first pass until the end of the first quarter, a completion to Kobayashi for 7 yards. The Pioneers clearly didn't fear Quentin in his first start. They practically dared Hokor to beat them with the pass. Adrienne struck again in the second quarter, hitting Westchester for a 52-yard strike. Quentin burned with jealousy at the Pioneer quarterback's long TD passes. He knew he could match the performance, especially against the run-oriented Pioneers defense, but he wasn't going to question Hokor anymore. He'd run the plays that were called. Quentin felt his pulse quicken when he took the field late in the second quarter, and Hokor finally outlined a passing attack.
Y set, double post. Test him downfield. If it's not open, don't throw, you got it?
Quentin nodded as he moved to the huddle.
Y set, double post, on two, on two.
The team seemed a bit listless in the huddle, as if they'd already conceded defeat. The only way to get them going, Quentin knew, was with a sustained drive or a big play. He broke the huddle and lined up. The Pioneers still showed a run defense, leaving Howick and Scarborough covered with only woman-to-woman coverage. Quentin calmed himself, knowing he had to be cool to take advantage of this opportunity.
Blue 15! Blue 15! green! Hot, hot!
Dropped straight back, eyes following Howick. Over to Scarborough, then back to Howick again. She already had a step on her defender. Quentin stepped up to throw, but the pocket collapsed almost immediately. A huge key lineman bore down on him from the left. Quentin dodged to his right, still looking downfield, but he sensed pressure on that side as well. He stepped up into the pocket, where Kagan met him head-on with a hit that knocked Quentin flat on his back. It was like being smacked with a wrecking ball, his eyes scrunched in pain. For second and long, Hooker called another pass. Kagan blitzed again. Quentin didn't have time to throw downfield and had to settle for a quick 5-yard strike to Warburg. Krakens tried to draw on the next play and got nowhere. Defeated once again, the offense ran off the field as the punt team came on. Quentin took off his helmet and threw it at the bench in disgust. He couldn't make things happen if he didn't have time to throw. He'd studied the Pioneers games over and over again. Their defensive line wasn't anything special. He had to get his O-line motivated. He started walking down the bench toward the key linemen were huddled in their big ball, but stopped. Donald Pine was already in front of them. Pine leaned heavily on his crutches, their tops digging into his armpits, leaving his hands free to flail about. Pine looked furious, madder than Quentin had ever seen him. Pine was screaming at them, up one side and down the other. And Quentin realized it was because the linemen listened to Pine. Once again, Pine seemed to be helping Quentin, not sabotaging him. Had he done the same thing in making Denver offer help for passing practice? At halftime, the game seemed to have slipped away. The Krakens were down 21-3, their only score coming on a nice 52-yard field goal by Ariok Morningstar. Quentin saw possibilities on almost every play, or thought he saw them, but he wasn't about to alter Hokor's calls. Maybe it was like before, like in the Hindrus game, and Hokor knew something that he didn't. He made the most out of the few opportunities that came his way, hitting 5 of his 11 passes for 82 yards. The completions were nice, but he spent most of the first half flat on his back, either knocked down after the pass, or dragged down, or one of the 3 first-half sacks, more sacks than he'd suffered his entire season with the Raiders. No touchdowns and 1 interception when a key tentacle deflected a pass at the line of scrimmage. Quentin had also scrambled for 22 rushing yards, far more out of necessity than choice. On the Kraken's home field, he could have run for much more, but the Pioneer field's slippery footing made it hard for him to make sharp cuts. The visitor's central locker room was filled with beings dressed in orange leg armor with black trim and orange jersey stained with streaks of oily yellow. Hokor stood in the middle of the circular room, his fur extended to its full length. He ranted and raved about the offensive line's poor showing, but much like Pine's lecture on the sidelines, nobody seemed to care. The Pioneers walked away with the game, winning by an embarrassing score of 35-10. Faid had managed one big play, breaking 3 tackles for a 24-yard run and the Kraken's only contribution to the weekly GSN highlight reel. Quentin undressed at his locker, feeling neither happy nor sad about the outcome. He played as well as could be expected under the circumstances being he'd finished the day 15 for 35 for 186 yards with 37 yards rushing. His body felt like he'd gone through 10 rounds in the octagon with Korak the Cutter, as it seemed the offensive line didn't really give a crap about protecting him. The Krakens changed in almost total quiet. They had 1 win, 2 losses, and were already 2 games out of first. Their chances of moving up to Tier 1 seemed near nil.
Tweety, you up for a night in the gambling district?
As Quentin pulled off his chest armor, Donald Pine hobbled over, the crutches making him awkward as he slowly sat.
You played well out there, Q.
Well, not that any of my so-called teammates would notice, or care for that matter.
Oh, they noticed. But you're right, they didn't care. I told you before, there's more to being a quarterback than skill and talent.
Listen, Gramps, I don't need a lecture.
Yeah, you do, Quentin. So did the offensive line, but they got theirs. Several, as a matter of fact.
Okay. Say what you gotta say.
Q, you've got all the talent in the world. It pours off you. Your brain works overtime. I see you come up with play adjustments that are almost as good as those of another Kraken's quarterback I know.
Yeah, well, Yitzhak is pretty damn creative.
Right. So you've got all the tools, but as you saw today, the greatest general in the world can't win if the troops won't go to war. The key linemen are not some random beings from their culture. They're soldiers. I've seen normal key citizens. Have you?
Quentin shrugged.
Just a few in the streets of Ionith City.
And did they look violent? Did they look strong?
No, they don't. They actually look about half the size of a lineman.
The difference between citizen and warrior isn't as dramatic as it is in the Quith culture, where there's a completely separate subspecies built for fighting, but it's there. Key soldiers are selected from a very young age, like the equivalent of 3 years old in humans. They're trained from that time in how to fight, kill, and endure pain and hardship that humans couldn't come close to handling. Most of our linemen have taken sentient life, Quentin, some with their bare hands, so to speak. All of them participated in ground combat at one point or another.
And that's supposed to excuse them for piss-poor blocking?
No, you don't get it. They love blocking. They love tackling. Physical combat is a huge part of their culture. But they aren't in control of this game. They're not calling the plays, they're just doing what they're told to do. Someone has to lead them, inspire them. And if they don't respect that someone, they simply don't try as hard.
So what you're telling me is that the big, mean, deadly key are kinda sensitive?
Pine smiled and nodded.
If you don't respect them, they're sure not going to respect you. And if they don't respect you, they're not following you. They're just going through the motions.
Quentin looked off in the distance.
Perilous! You up for a night in the gambling district?
No, I'm good.
Come on!
Isud flitted about Tom Perilous like a big mosquito. He had obviously run out of people to go gambling with, and Perilous was his last hope. Quentin looked back at Pine.
Okay, so what do I do about it?
You really want to know? You're not going to like it.
Quentin nodded.
The key are a very tight species. They send nerve impulses through their skin and vocal tubes. That's why they cluster up like that all the time, on the sidelines and at night. When they're touching, they can kind of talk without speaking. That also makes for closeness among them. Gives them a sense of tribe or of family.
So they're not just sensitive. They're also touchy-feely.
Pine shrugged his shoulders.
I didn't cause the revolution, I just study it.
They're revolting.
So what? Do you want to win games or not?
Quentin nodded.
Fine. You have to stop acting like they have the plague. Touch them, hug them the way you would any human player who did something good.
I don't really do hugs.
You know what I mean. Get it in your head that you have to stop thinking of different races and start seeing all of them, Key, Quith, and Sklorno, as your teammates. Look, maybe you didn't need to bond with your PNFL teammates because you could win games single-handedly. But these players are the best a galaxy has to offer, and your goal has got to be making them play as a team.
I don't know, man. Seems like Kretorok propaganda that we all have to get along as one giant race of sentience. Does it really work?
Pine smiled and held up his right hand, fingers outstretched. Glittering championship rings adorned his middle and ring fingers. Quentin nodded. Pine was trying to help him, probably had been all along. No one had ever helped Quentin before. Not without wanting something in return. And Pine not only wanted nothing, he had everything to lose by helping Quentin. The more Pine helped, the more likely he was to lose his starting job. Quentin realized he had one of the greatest players in the game trying to help him, and he treated that help like some kind of underhanded trick.
Pine, why are you doing this?
Doing what?
Helping me.
Pine stared, confused.
Because you need it. Why else?
Yeah, but if you help me and I get better...
Pine nodded.
I'm helping you because you're my teammate. You get that yet? I need a backup that can win games. Besides, my career only has a few years left, I know that. It would be nice to, well, have someone to teach. Someone to I don't know.
Carry on the Don Pine tradition?
Pine smiled.
Sure, that works.
Thanks.
Quentin extended his right hand, which Pine shook.
I've got a good idea on how to take your advice.
Pine nodded and hobbled away. Quentin stood and finished removing his armor. He pulled on a robe, then hit the service button in his locker. Nassal appeared as if out of thin air.
You rang, sir?
Nassal, I've had it with these nanite showers.
Is there a problem, sir?
No problem, some steaming hot water won't fix. Get Chisel over here.
Chisel flew small circles around Quentin's head.
You sure you want to do this? They have been known to eat humans, you know.
Just be quiet until I need you to translate.
Nassal led them to the key locker room.
Key eyes take in a larger spectrum of light than human eyes. Consequently, only a few purple lights provide any illumination. So watch your step.
The key locker room was dark and hot. Goodwill or no goodwill, there was no denying the place stank. Quentin had thought pre-game key odors were bad. But his nose let him know that those were nothing compared to the post-game smells. The room smelled like rotten fish mixed in with decomposed chicken guts. Quentin ignored the smell and followed Missal to the back. Missal opened a door and bowed as Quentin passed. Steam billowed out of the open door and up onto the ceiling, making hazy purple clouds where it crossed in front of the dim lights. Quentin stood at the open door for 1 second. Quentin entered. One step inside the door, and Quentin stopped cold. A deep pool of water sat in the middle of the circular room. The low lights made the water look black. Dozens of shower heads ringed the ceiling, angling water down to the mass of creatures bundled up in the pool center. They sat there, a giant entwined ball of worm-like bodies, multi-jointed legs, pinkish mouths lined with black teeth, muscular, multi-jointed arms, orange-colored skin without end, and thousands of reddish-brown spots of enamel, each wet and glistening like a black ruby. They look like a coiled, multi-headed dragon straight out of the holy book. None of them turned their heads to look when Quentin entered. They didn't have to. Their unblinking black eyes let them see everything at once. The ball of body seemed to move, to slide just a bit, and one figure slithered out of the pack. The long, thick body splashed water out of the pool and onto the tile floor as it moved slowly towards Quentin. Oddly enough, he instantly recognized the oncoming Momo Killo. Maybe they didn't all look alike after all. The temperamental rookie walked up until he was only a few inches from Quentin.
He wants to know what you think you're doing here.
Quentin swallowed. There was a whole room of them, and he was just in a robe. He wanted to leave, but he wanted to win more. Two losses were enough.
This is the only room with water showers.
He says that you should go.
Quentin stepped to Momo Killo's right, gently shouldering past the huge key as he did. The boldness of the move seemed to surprise Killo, for it was one full second before Quentin sensed the lineman reaching out for him. Quentin avoided the multi-jointed arms by quickly diving into the water. The water was almost scalding. It felt miraculous against his skin. He arched and swam upwards, his face breaking the surface only a few feet from the giant ball of alien linemen. Momo Killo started to splash towards Quentin, but Killo Yawet, the left tackle, spoke up. Momo Killo stopped short of Quentin, stared at him for a second, then slithered back into the ball.
Killo Yawet says you can stay.
Quentin kicked back to the pool's edge. He draped his arms in the tile, and his body sank in up to his chest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.